Welcome to Incognito, the podcast, where I converse with interesting guests from a variety of fields and disciplines about how they foster inclusive workplaces and communities. In today's show, Eric Grant and I have a deep yet fun conversation, which seems to center around the word why. He has a lot to say about why it is so important to use that word and why we need more people to practice intellectual curiosity. He's a guy that says exactly what is on his mind, which I think you'll find refreshing and perhaps even challenging. Welcome to Incognito, the podcast. I'm your host, Michael Fosberg, and with me today is Eric Grant. Eric is the managing partner and financial advisor with Polaris Wealth Management, a firm that specializes in insurance, investments, and financial advisory services for individual and businesses. Eric has over 35 years of experience and knowledge in personal and business financial services, and is a speaker and lecturer on matters related to personal and business financial planning. He also expresses himself as the host of a two-hour weekly national radio show, The Family Meeting, on WCPT, AM and FM, and has been a contributor to various media outlets, including Black Enterprise, The Wall Street Journal, and WVON Radio. He's a proud Howard University alum with a Bachelor of Business Administration degree in finance and insurance, and most important, a husband and father. Eric.
Most important.
Most important. Welcome to the podcast.
Good to be here.
It's good to have you. You know, we were talking just before we started recording. It's tables turned now. You get to be interviewed, if we can call it that. And you're always interviewing people on your show. So there.
Are you on social media yet?
We've had this running, Eric and I've had this running debate about social. Yes, I am on Instagram.
What?
Yes, what? Incognito the Play is on Instagram. You can find me there 7 days a week. Well, I'm not.
Yeah, you're almost grown now. Look at that.
Yeah, right. I'm old and weary of being on Instagram. Thanks a lot for that, by the way. Eric insisted that I needed to have a presence on social media, and so thus, Incognito is on.
Yeah, but tell them why, though. Tell them why. Because we need your voice.
You need my voice, yes.
All the imbeciles who are out there on social media.
Yes, yes. Well, I don't know that my voice is very loud on that platform. I feel very silent, very small and silent. But I'm on, and I'm posting. So,
good.
Yeah. I want to go back. I'm going to go back to the introduction, just because this is something I talk about with all my guests. And I know that this, you know, you gave me actually a very long and detailed, I guess I call it a bio, but information sheet on you. But I condensed it down to just those few parts. And we've sort of jokingly at the end of the bio, the most important part, a husband and father. But I want to ask you a little bit more specifically, you know, aside from the accomplishments, aside from the 35 years in financial planning and whatnot, how do you see yourself? What are the identities that are core to how you see yourself in the world?
Ooh, okay. I wish I'd read your questions in advance.
Too late.
Listen, the first thing that comes to mind is a professor I had in college, a Dr. Adeboye. And Dr. Adeboye is a math professor. And I don't know if it was calculus, whatever class he taught that he had. But the thing that impressed me the most is Dr. Adeboye would walk into class with a piece of chalk in his hand, right? And he would turn to one of the students regularly and say, okay, what page were we on last? And the student would tell him, and he would say, ah, and he'd go to the board and start writing. He knew that book and his material cold, where he could walk around with a piece of chalk and teach math. And I always told myself, I want to be like that kind of guy. Add to that, part of the impetus for my radio show was the question of what's normal.
What's normal, you said?
What's normal? Right. You remember back in the Cosby Show came on?
Yeah, sure.
You had a black doctor and a black attorney who were doing well for themselves. And a lot of people walked around and said, well, that's not realistic. That's not normal. And my question was, why not? So I try to live a life where if I'm doing good things, I refuse to accept the accolades for doing good, for doing right, because it should just be normal. Don't congratulate me for doing something that's normal. And that's my little contribution to establishing what I call a new normal.
I guess it would depend on one's definition of normal.
Isn't that really the problem, though?
How yeah, we yeah. I would agree.
Right. It's filled with all kind of prejudices and all manner of things. When they decide that, when they look at me and see a black guy, they're trying to, in a hoodie. Right?
A Howard hoodie. Can we add a Howard hoodie to that?
It's the Howard hoodie, right.
Okay.
They size you up. And so right. What's normal? Right. What's normal? Can we change what's normal? Right. And so a lot of the things I do day to day are about changing what's normal.
Yeah, it's interesting. I think about that. And I think, well, one of the things I think about is Trayvon Martin, because that was the big identifier for him, was he was wearing a hoodie. And shortly after he was killed, they had all these pictures across social media of right-wing conservatives who were very critical of him, of Trayvon, all out and about in hoodies and how they, you know, that's normal for them. So, yeah, I kind of love that. I think, again, getting, you know, talking about definitions of words and how someone might interpret normal differently than the way you do or the way I do, we're going to get a little bit more into that later in our conversation about the word authenticity. So you carry yourself in the world just trying to establish what you consider normal so that others will accept you for who you are.
More than that is to raise the bar.
Raise the bar.
Right. So yeah. If it's normal, so my children, I'm proud of my children. They're very accomplished, very smart kids, did well in school, the whole nine.
Yeah.
And everybody's congratulating me for the kids doing well. I say, well, damn, the kids are supposed to do well. If you put the time in, they're supposed to do well. Now, if my kids cure cancer, then you can congratulate me, but don't congratulate me for raising good kids. That's what I'm supposed to do.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to push the bar, you know?
Right. I think we've lost that sense of, I don't know how else to put it, but as you put it, that sense of normal, like, yes, I'm supposed to raise my kids well. I'm supposed to be a good, compassionate, loving, caring person. Don't congratulate me for that. I think that's a really great, great thing to help people become aware of. I guess this is sort of in line with what we're just talking about here, but I want to ask you if you, and I know you're in a have some stories on this, but have you ever felt walking into a room that your identity, whether it was normal or as a black man or as a guy in a hoodie, a Howard hoodie, have you ever felt walking into a room that your identity was or might be an obstacle?
You haven't been a black man as long as I have.
Well, we know that's true.
Look, man, the reality for me as a black man is that knowingly or unknowingly, I and others are spending a good deal of our time trying to either justify our presence wherever we are or make people comfortable with our presence. So I look at those instances where I go to conferences, and it happens to me frequently, where I'm the only black guy there. And I'm generally a free-spirited guy. I don't really care what anybody thinks, but I can feel myself attempting to make people comfortable with my presence or justifying. Because there are occasions where people have asked me, you know, where's the bathroom? Like, I work there. That happens to me as well. And so that's really, really burdensome to have to do that.
Yeah.
I just recall I had a discussion with a family friend, a white lady, and she goes to an all-white church, right? And so we were having one of those really involved conversations that I have a tendency to stir up. And she said, well, listen, I'd really like to get more people of color to come to my church. And I had really three essential questions. One is, okay, is your church all white? Why is it all white? And when I ask questions like that, it's not rhetorical. I want to know the answer.
Yes.
Think, why is it all white? Second question is, why don't you go to their church? Why do they have to come to your church?
Yeah.
And then third, I asked her if she understood the reality that I just described. And oftentimes, HBCUs and black churches are the only places we can go where we don't carry that burden of having to justify our presence or make people comfortable with our presence. So we don't want to be around white people. That's why we go to our churches. So you may be taking people out of their comfort zone and making them uncomfortable by going to church with you Why don't you go to their church? Yeah. Oh, in the ghetto. Why is it a ghetto? Why is it that way?
Yeah.
And again, it's not rhetorical. I want you, damn it, to answer my question.
Yes.
Why is it?
Yes.
Because that leads to a lot of the root of the problem. Because
mm-hmm.
we accept that. So we accept that that neighborhood is like it is and my neighborhood is like it is. Why do we accept that?
Yeah.
So you got to ask those questions.
Yeah.
And so I think you asked me about, you know, my identity in the room as an obstacle. It's always an obstacle, and I'm always working to overcome it. But I also carry a good deal of indifference. It comes with age and wisdom, right?
It's a couple of things. One, I'm thinking about the phrase that I've heard quite often, the most segregated hour in America is church on Sunday morning.
Right.
I'm also thinking about, so the indifference and sussing up the reality of the situation that you've walked into, how do you bring people over to understand that we're all on the same team?
Wow. That's a good question. So in work, one of my tactics, and I'm kind of spilling the beans here, is to spend a lot of time making people feel like my idea was their idea.
Mm.
And it takes a little bit of maneuvering and a little bit of finesse. As a person who doesn't have a supersized ego and doesn't need credit for great ideas, it's a little easier for me to do that.
Mm.
So I've adopted a lot of language. I've done it with my children too.
Really?
Where, you know, I want you to clean your room. I want it to be their idea. Like they thought about doing it, clean their room. And it takes some maneuvering to do that.
Yeah.
But I think collaboration comes from a high level intellectual curiosity. I mean, true intellectual curiosity. The best person I've seen to express a really healthy level of intellectual curiosity is Larry King. If you ever watch his interviews, he asks really poignant questions and he may or may not be actually interested in the answer, but you feel like he's interested in the answer. And people don't often remember what you said, but they always remember how you made them feel.
Mm-hmm.
I think Larry King was successful because he made people feel like he was listening.
Mm.
And that becomes the core of developing collaboration. Intellectual curiosity, true intellectual curiosity. Don't ask questions as fillers and demand an answer. Nothing's rhetorical.
Right, right. A recent guest on the podcast shared I guess it was from Ted Lasso, but the line of be curious, not judgmental. I thought that was so deeply poignant.
It is.
But this idea that why wouldn't you want to be curious? I wouldn't say that I necessarily listen to a lot of Larry King interviews, but the idea of being more curious than suddenly tacking on some sort of judgment about someone is just leaving you in a much better place to learn and to grow.
Right. Yeah. The word why is a powerful word.
Yeah.
Why? You know, why is it that way?
Yeah.
Why does it have to be that way?
Right.
Here's the reverse psychology that I apply sometimes, right? So you'll hear people say, well, why is that community so bad? Why is there so much crime in that community?
Mm-hmm.
And my question is, why isn't there a crime in your community?
Mm.
The answer to that question tells you a lot about the solution for the community you're concerned about.
Right.
And just let them talk. Why? Just keep saying why over and over. I do that with clients all the time. Why? Why do you want to do that? Why is that important to you? I do whys all the time.
Yeah.
And the answers you have to get to like the fourth why before you get a real answer. But the answer to the question why is always important.
Yeah, it's very much like, it's very childlike in so many ways, because continuing to ask the question why really gets at the deep root of what you're trying to get at. So, you know, you shared a little bit of a story earlier in our conversation here, but I want to ask you about a specific challenging situation that you found yourself in that required unifying efforts on your part and how you overcame that challenge.
Sounds like a job interview, man. So one of the things that's always, as a financial advisor,
yes,
one of the things that's always a challenge that I think I've managed to kind of figure out is an instance where you're trying to help or render financial advice to a couple, usually a married couple.
Mm-hmm.
Could be two business partners, but when you've got two minds,
mm-hmm.
where I find myself most of the time, and a lot of the training I do for my associates is around understanding that people measure their self-worth by their financial success, mm-hmm. or lack thereof. And I think that's inseparable. I don't know if you can change that.
Yeah.
But in the case of a couple or a partnership, there are oftentimes a lot of things that they either haven't talked about or have talked about and haven't successfully resolved any differences. And a lot of what I do as a financial advisor requires those differences to be resolved. So I become kind of a junior Dr. Phil oftentimes in these discussions, whereas I have to more or less pick a fight and tell these people, listen, we have to talk about this today. We're going to have to come to a resolution today.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah, it sounds like you have talked about this before and you haven't worked it out, or you thought about it and you decided don't talk about it anymore so we can stay happy. Now we got to talk about it. I've become fairly skilled, I think, in picking that fight and extracting common ground with partners or married couples. And, you know, go deep and go hard. So listen, if a wife says, well, listen, I want this, and I'll turn to the husband and say, sound like she doesn't like what you like, man. What do you say about that? And get him going, right? And then he'll say what he has to say. Wait a minute, hold on a second. But I like hers better. Why should we go with yours? And just pick the fight, get them back and forth and make them talk it out. And so that's always challenging because it can get out of control if you don't know what you're doing. And now you've ruined a marriage if you don't do it right. But it has to be done. That's probably the most challenging at this point.
Is that on your business card, financial therapist?
Listen, man, you could ask my clients. They'll tell you it feels like a counseling session when they finish talking to me. I talk so much about money in my sessions now, it's unbelievable.
Wow.
So I'm about the psychology behind, why are we doing this?
Yeah.
And just have them talk it out. And oftentimes it's some life experience that traumatized you and then you do this now because you don't want that to happen again. It's all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
When you comb all that stuff away, in my business at least, the financial management part is easy. Mm. It's almost all addition and subtraction,
mm-hmm.
which we all can do.
Mm-hmm.
It's the emotions behind why you're doing that.
Mm. Yeah, I like what you said about, because obviously this is deeply a part of the work that I do, extracting common ground. Because as we've talked before, my big focus is on this fact that we have more in common than we have different. And yet we're not really talking to one another to find those commonalities. We're talking past one another or around one another. And sounds like that, you know, is kind of what you're advocating in your sessions, is that you need to talk to one another and extracting that common ground.
Yep. Inside of an hour too, by the way.
I hope you're getting a top financial therapy rates for that.
Yeah. Wish I did, man. Don't pay me enough for this.
Uh-oh, careful. You don't want to, you know, measure your self-worth with your financial worth.
Well, everybody eats and they've been educated, so it's enough for that at least. So.
That's good. So I don't know, maybe this is what you've just answered, but how do you go about forging new connections with people in your workplace or perhaps in your community? I mean, are there ways or methods or techniques or, I don't know, approaches or habits or rules that you strive by to forge connections with people? I mean, obviously you're a very talkative and fun-loving guy. I mean, we connected immediately and had a great time in the studio the couple of times I've been there with you and your partner, Richard. But how do you go about forging connections with people?
So there were two things my father taught me, told me directly. The first one was, in order to have good friends, you've got to be a good friend.
Mm.
And so if you just focus on being a good friend, you'll have good friends and good relationships and good coworkers, so on and so forth. The other thing is, the most selfish thing you can do is to be unselfish.
Mm.
And you got to listen to that twice. Some people have to listen to it twice to hear.
Say it again.
The most selfish thing you can do is to be unselfish.
Explain.
Because if you're giving of yourself, if you're being unselfish, you get more from that than you give.
Mm.
The most selfish thing you can do is to be unselfish. And so I am, to a fault, generous. I am, for people that I've decided are my friends, and there are lots of them, you can't do or say anything to change that.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing you can do or say to change that. You got a friend in me. And as a result, I have lots and lots of really good friends who I can count on for all manner of things. And it makes really, really good life. It is far more valuable than any of the monetary or material resources that I have, the friendships.
The friendships.
So I value friendships beyond anything. And so I spent a lot of time in that philosophy, in that line of thinking. I am going to be a good friend to you. If you need me and I can, I will.
Yeah.
Now, I may forget. I may get bogged down with other things. It doesn't mean it's not important.
Yeah.
But you can count on me to be a good friend. You can rely on that. And I don't know anybody who would say otherwise about me at this point, at least not to my face.
Those are obviously very, very wonderful ways to navigate our lives. I think making the connections with people, just the idea of the word connections and connecting with people talks deeply about our friendships with one another and how valuable those are for our overall sense of self and health. You know, this question I'm going to ask you is it might be also very, very related to what you just talked about, but maybe there's something else. And I want to go deeper if there is. If there was one thing that you could recommend to our listeners that could act as a catalyst for a more inclusive society or a workplace, what would that one thing be?
Oh, my God. Intellectual curiosity is one of the buzzwords that I throw around a lot.
Yeah, I like that. I like that.
And unfortunately, we've got a lot of intellectually lazy people, and a lot of them reside on social media. I can't tell you how many people, as a radio host, how many people have sent me articles for which they've only read the headline. Right? And I read the article and say, well, this doesn't say what you think it says, man. Did you even read this? It happens so incredibly often.
Really? Wow.
I mean, just intellectual laziness is the scourge, I think, of society. Because if you were intellectually curious, you wouldn't think some of the things you think about some of the people you think about them. You just wouldn't do it, right? If you don't ask. So being intellectually curious and using that word why over and over and over, I think that begins to build an inclusive society. If you're at a law firm now and the whole firm is white, why? Why is it all white?
Yeah.
15% of the population is black. Whatever percent of the population is Hispanic, why is your firm all white?
Yes.
Answer the damn question, right? Why? The answer will tell you everything you need to know, right? So, you know, there are studies, and I'm sure you've read them, that speak to the value, the economic value of diversity.
Yes, indeed.
Okay, so you got an all white firm. We got the study that says that you could make so much more money if you were diverse. Why are you doing that?
It's like the owner of the Boston Red Sox. He was the last person to integrate his team.
Yeah.
Even though it hurt his pocketbook.
Right. Why are you doing it? Why in the 50s and the 60s, why are you spending the money to build two bathrooms so you don't have to be in the same bathroom with black people? Why are you doing it? Couldn't you do something better with that?
Yeah.
Right. So, you know, to the extent you have people like you and I who are intellectually curious and continue to ask why, and look for answers. This is not a gotcha question. This is not a question that we should be asking to go one up on somebody. Just why? Let's talk out why. Why is it that? I think inclusiveness comes from asking why.
Mm.
The really deep intellectual curiosity that should follow the why. You really got to want to know the answer.
Yeah.
So if the answer is, well, we're just racist and we don't want any black people here, fine.
Fine. At least we know why.
Right. Even though the data says that you can be so much more rich, you've decided to forego your wealth.
Right.
In favor of not having people who you don't like for whatever reason.
Right.
So I think it starts there. That's what I do on my broadcast. I ask that question.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Yeah. Have you been, since the Supreme Court did away with affirmative action due to Edward Blum and his organization, have you been talking about that on your radio show?
I've been asking, why did it get to that point?
Yeah.
So here's a great question I ask all the time. And I get this from people who've decided that they're going to be really, really bold with me without being in front of me. They don't know I'm a 6'2", 220-pound black man. But so the assertion is, you'll like this. The assertion is that racism is no more.
Right.
So there's two assumptions you can make from that statement, right? One, that means at some point we were a racist society, right?
Indeed.
So if we were and we're not, the question is, what day did it end? Tell me what day it was. No, I mean that. What day it was? Tell me what day it was. Thursday last week? What day it was?
Yeah.
Okay, you can't remember which day. You can't remember what day it was? What month? How about what year?
Right.
So if you can't answer that question in the affirmative, that this was the year or this was the month or the day it ended, then it still exists.
Yeah.
So then what are you going to do about it? Why is it that way?
Yeah. This is something that I talk about, and I'm actually doing a solo podcast coming up that is going to talk a little bit more about Edward Blum and his work and how he's now, you mentioned law firms. He's now suing law firms who are offering fellowships to African-American women and men who are underrepresented in their firms. He's suing NASDAQ for requiring firms listed on their site to have at least two female board members and members of color on their boards. He's suing them for that. I mean, it's just what's happening is crazy to me. It feels so much like we're moving backwards instead of forwards. And I guess I would have to say out the same thing. Why? Why is this happening?
Yeah, why are we even engaged in a conversation about affirmative action? Yeah. Why is it even?
Well, I'm not going to conjecture that I know the answer to that, but I think that from what I hear and what I read and digest, it feels like one side feels like something is being taken away from them by giving you something, you speaking of people of color and the LGBTQ community, we're giving you something, which means I'm losing something by giving you that, which is, couldn't be further from the case, but that's what it appears.
Why do they think that? You know, the question, why do they think?
Yeah. Yeah.
What's the data that tells you that that is in fact the case?
Well, they don't have the data that for that. Yes, exactly.
But you got to get them to answer you though.
That's right.
For the affirmative action thing, as it relates to colleges and universities, it's actually a boon for HBCUs.
Yeah.
The problem is that the HBCUs have a real capacity problem.
Yeah.
My alma mater, Howard, we can house just over half of our 7,000 undergraduate students in Washington, D.C., where it's expensive as hell.
Yeah.
So that's a problem. We get 35,000 applications for Howard University every year.
Ooh.
For about 1,700 spots.
Wow.
So, you know, what do you do with those other 30,000, 32,000 spots, the people that want to go to a place like Howard?
Yeah.
The university have to figure out a way to establish capacity.
Yeah.
And so the lack of, here's how it goes full circle. The lack of wealth in the community doesn't support the university in a way that allows it to expand its capacity.
Yeah.
Why is it that way? You got to start answering the questions.
Indeed. Mm-hmm. I want to ask you, because you to me really embody this, but I have to ask because not only do I ask all my guests, but because I really feel you're going to have something really truly meaningful to share. But I ask, if I were to ask you what it means to be authentic, how would you describe that? And what does that look like for you?
Boy, Michael, damn, that's a weed smoking question, man.
That's a gray-haired question.
You know, there's a lot of things that come to mind when you use the word authentic.
Yeah.
Wow. So a lot of times people mistake authenticity for unfriendliness or bluntness.
Mm.
I'm a person who you can rely on to say exactly what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that would fit in the category of authentic. I'm almost always my real me. The only person I'm not my real me around is my wife, because I temper myself. But for anybody else, I say exactly what's on my mind.
Do you want me to edit that out of this conversation?
No, she knows.
Okay. All right.
You know, so I like to believe that I'm authentic. We both know people who are not authentic.
Mm-hmm.
If your question is how do you, I'm adding to your question now, watch this.
Yeah.
Is how can you bring out your inner authenticity?
Yeah.
I think it's born out of a healthy dose of indifference. To the extent you don't care what people think, I think it crafts your behavior. As men, for instance, I don't know that we would ever wash or shave but for women, right? Because we care what women think. I mean, if women didn't matter, we would drive any old car. Probably would cut us, right? But because of women, got to have a nice car, you know, that and dress nice and wash, that kind of stuff.
Those essentials.
Right. So am I being authentic if I don't wash? maybe. But I think authenticity is in short supply because of the exterior stimulus that we all endure that is supercharged by things like social media.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, one of the reasons I also posed the question, because everybody sees it slightly differently. And there are some very troubling things about authenticity that I can't quite square. And, you know, for instance, I'm sure, I'm not sure, but I'm pretty sure that most Trump supporters would see him as very authentic. To me, that's really troubling because I don't see anything authentic about him whatsoever. But again, that's
you don't?
No.
I think he's really, really stupid.
He's authentically stupid is what you're saying.
Yeah. I mean, look at this hand thing he does all the time.
Yeah.
Right? That's stupid. That's just plain stupidity.
Yeah, but we see it like that. That's what I'm saying is, like, I can't understand and I can't really look into the minds of those who follow him, or, you know, whatever we want to say, are part of the cult or whatever, why they find that so authentic. It's because we see the word or the actuality of authenticity differently. And that's why I think it's such an interesting topic to converse about. It's like, what is it that makes someone authentic, or what is it that they see in someone that makes them feel they're authentic?
Wait a minute. So help me understand here then. So if he's not authentic, how then do you define authenticity in general and with him?
Who's doing this interview?
I'm just curious, man. Intellectual curiosity.
I mean, I would concur with, I guess, a lot of things that guests have said in the past. And what I feel about it is the word that's most associated with it, I guess, would be honesty, being honest and truthful and being singularly, as you put it, yourself. But all of those things to me would be different than they are to him or to anyone who follows him, per se. Does that make sense?
No, because I think it sounds like you're conflating honesty and authenticity.
Well, if you look up the word authenticity, honesty is a part of the definition of authenticity.
Okay, well, he's dishonest. But I think he's
dishonest. Exactly. But they don't necessarily, and I don't want to, you know, separate by saying them and us, because I hate when we do that. But they would say that he is honest, that he is being truthful, that he is, you know, all of these things.
I guess so. And this is me not having looked up the word authentic to deal with it. So I'm working off of my street definition.
Well, again, honesty, sincerity, these are words that are associated or a part of the definition of authenticity. And again, the way that we see it is probably very similar, as you said earlier, being my true self, being a truth. Truth is a part of authenticity.
So it's a part of authenticity.
Yeah, sure.
What else is a part of authenticity?
Again, honesty, sincerity, being real. But all of these words are in ways synonymous with one another. Real, truth, honesty, sincerity, authenticity, all of them are synonymous.
Mm. See, the way you're defining it, I don't know that I would put as much weight in authenticity. I don't know that I would.
Weight in terms of?
Of maybe the weight of importance. I don't know that I need somebody to be authentic as much as I need him to be honest. Because the way you described it, you sound like honesty was a part of authenticity.
Yes.
I mean, I don't know. Again, I haven't looked at the word, the definition of authenticity.
Yes.
So I'm not always honest.
Yeah.
None of us are always honest.
Well, wow, this is a huge conversation.
Wife walks up on you and says, "How does this dress look on me?" And it looks horrible.
Yes.
You don't dare say that.
Yes. There is truth in that. There is truth in that. There, I use the word. There is truth in that. No, that's absolutely true. But I don't know that necessarily negates your authenticity.
So what are the other components then? I'm asking you a question now. What are the other components that round out authenticity?
Well, being oneself, one's true self, and whatever that means. And so to me, You're laughing already because you've been joking with me since we met about being the white guy who discovered he's black. I mean, that to me is a part, he's laughing now again, that to me is a part of my authenticity, is owning that and what that means over the course of my life and in sharing that with people and being, here I'm going to use the word, real with you or others. All of that is a part of my authenticity.
You don't mind me laughing at you, do you?
No, not at all. I know it's good natured that we have a rapport.
Your story is one of the funniest things I've ever heard, man.
Well, it's funny, and it's actually, you know, it's been a great opportunity for me to help people see things about race and identity. I feel, you know, really blessed to be able to share my story, whether it's on your radio show or whether it's in the form of a one-man play in which I go and stand in front of a group of lawyers or doctors or engineers or high school students and challenge them again on how we see ourselves and how we look at other people.
When I told Rich, I said, guess what? He's black. Funniest thing. But, you know, I think it was James Baldwin one time that said, there's a whole lot of things I don't know, but the one thing I do know is that white America would never want to be a black person.
Yeah, he said
that. Right? So why is that? There's the why again. Why is that? Right.
Exactly. I think he actually used the word, why is that? He actually used that question. Why is that? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, you're exactly right.
Yeah.
And as it relates to honesty and authenticity, I mean, I'm starting to feel like it's a throwaway word.
Authenticity or honesty?
I don't know that I could walk up on somebody and insist on our friendship being contingent upon you being authentic.
Yeah.
I don't know that matters to me.
Yeah. I don't know that we would. I totally agree with you. I don't know that we would go and use that word in terms of, are you authentic with me or not? I think it's a sense or a feeling that we get from someone. And it can encompass all of these different things that we've talked about, whether, again, it's truthful, honesty, real, having a sense of themselves. And these are different things that different guests have shared in the past. You shared, you know, just really being yourself, straightforward, not going to hide the questions that you're going to ask. That's a part of who you are. That's the authentic part of you. But I'm not going to go up to you and go, I don't know if you're authentic or not. It's a sense that we'll get. And I think you've nailed it right there in that statement.
It's how I make you feel.
Yeah, exactly. I don't want to cut this conversation short because we could talk about this for a really long time. You and I could talk for a very, very long time, but I like to try to keep the podcast on the shorter side. So I want to try to bring the threads together for an ending here. And I want to ask you one last question that you might share with listeners. If you could, I don't know, recommend something, a book, a movie, a play, a television show that you have digested recently that has really inspired you, and tell us why.
Yeah, let me give you three books and one play.
Terrific. Fantastic.
In order, books, Cast, C-A-S-T-E, Cast.
Yes, by Isabella Wilkerson. Yes, I am a huge, huge fan of her work. Her first book, The Warmth of Other Suns, is one of my favorite all-time books.
That's my second book. And then the third one is the autobiography of Malcolm X.
Ah, yes, indeed.
That's a required reading of almost every Howard student.
Yeah.
By the way, Brother Minister Malcolm is the quintessential American citizen. His story in and of itself is the story of an American.
Yeah.
And everybody to read that.
Yeah.
Play-wise, best play I've ever seen was Twisted Melodies. Is a one-man play about the life of Donny Hathaway. And he sings Donny Hathaway songs master. I encourage everybody, if you can, look up clips on YouTube of Kelvin doing Donny Hathaway. It's an amazing journey.
Eric, thank you so much for your time and your, I'm going to call it wisdom. And your wisdom for sharing with us today. I really, really appreciate it.
Good to see you, man. We'll talk soon.
Thanks again for listening to Incognito, the podcast, as we begin our fifth season. If you are unfamiliar with the podcast, I record 10 episodes, which we call a season, take a break for about 8 weeks, and then return with a new season of 10 conversations. Every once in a while, I tackle a solo episode, but mostly the conversations are with a variety of folks from a wide spectrum of business and the arts. This season, I am beyond excited for you to listen in. There will be a lot of great conversations and information for you to digest. If you're a new listener, welcome. I hope you found something here you can use in your work, life, or community. And if you are returning, I'm so happy to have your continued support. I personally listen to a good number of podcasts and realize how difficult it can be to sustain listenership over time. So for those of you who can call yourselves longtime listeners, I really appreciate that you still find value and interest in what is being said here. As always, we welcome your suggestions and encourage you to rate and comment in your podcast app. Ratings and comments help people find us and allows us to spread the word about this work. Also, you can find us on Instagram at IncognitoThePlay, all one word, IncognitoThePlay. Find us there, follow us, and hit us up with a question or comment. And since we have a limited social media presence, I am urging you to take an additional step to tell someone you know about this work. I'll be back again next week with yet another conversation that delves deeply into identity, authenticity, and ways in which we can create inclusive communities and workspaces.